big-ass space rock that spanked the Earth? Well, a chunk of it has landed danged close to home. And also, hey, we found 1, 2, 3 people who prefer their rice with gravity? And one of our star reporters has returned, wearing nothing but a paper bag. Sit back, buckle up. It's time for today's slice.
Covering all the news from every dark corner of the universe. SliceofSciFi.com.
Hey, greetings everyone to another Slice of Sci-Fi. I am Michael R. Menengay.
I'm Ben Ragginton.
I'm Sam Roberts.
I'm Keith Lane.
I'm Megan Zier. And
special guest in the studio today,
from Technorama.
Hi, I'm Chuck Tomasi. You remember me from such shows as Technorama, Tech Now, and the voiceover guy from the ServiceNow videos.
I'm having serious flashbacks now.
I know, it's crazy. Hey, Chuck joins us in the studio. Thanks for coming by, man.
You're welcome. Awesome. Thanks for having me.
He's here to listen to us do the news.
Oh, no.
What a concept.
Your news team is next.
So last month, loyal viewer, dear friend, and all-around fascinating guy, Geoff Notkin, the meteorite man, gave us his insight and perspective on the February meteorite event that occurred over Russia, causing widespread damage and leaving, sadly, more than 1,000 people injured.
Yes.
Last week, Geoff announced he had obtained a fragment of the actual meteorite and was immediately making it available for public viewing, because he's cool like that. So then, naturally, fellow nerd Mike rushed right over to the Challenger Space Center to talk
just
to
like that,
about his latest acquisition.
Just like that.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
What'd you learn, Mike? How'd it go?
Well, I actually had a really good conversation with him, and I've got a little piece of that right now.
Awesome.
You guys probably are. February 15 of this year, there was an enormous meteorite event, a fireball, subsequent explosion, and shower of meteorite fragments over the Russian city of Chelyabinsk.
Chelyabinsk. I had Chetnya.
Well,
I had Chetnya in my head for some reason, but that's not right.
You have good pronunciation.
Well, that's good, because my English isn't so good.
English good too. Chelyabinsk.
This was the largest meteorite event since the Sokolin fall of 1947, which, by the most amazing coincidence, also took place in Russia. And I'm often asked, Geoff, we've had Chelyabinsk 2013, Sokolin 1947, Tunguska, the mysterious one, 1908 in Siberia, all these enormous meteorite-related events in Russia. So people go, what's the deal? Why does everything land in Russia? And the secret answer is,
because it's a really big target.
It's a really big space, yeah. We should be talking about China, too, because China actually has a lot of strikes as well. We just don't hear about them nearly as much, right? Isn't that correct?
Well, and I'm sure that they collect all the meteorites that fall, and they grind them up, and they research them, and they try to extract secret information that they can use against us.
Oh, yeah.
later, in the upcoming World War, we're not supposed to mention. Just kidding!
We don't get political here.
We're just a small joke.
Yes.
Anyway,
such a small joke.
I digress again. The reason we're at Challenger is to unveil a marvelous piece of the Chelyabinsk meteorite, which was
picked up. This is one you didn't find, right?
It's unusual.
I was going to say, you're the meteorite guy. You're supposed to be getting all of them.
I know. But, you know, fair is fair. It's a big planet. Quite a few meteorites fall. It would be, I'd be sort of like that obnoxious kid from next door who takes your wagon right after your birthday if I went out and collected all the meteorites. The truth is, I did not go to the site of the Russian fall for two reasons. One is,
very, very cool stuff.
Cliffhanger!
Cliffhanger there for you. You need to go check it out. You can see the entire interview. And I had a lot of fun with Geoff. Geoff's just a great guy, of course. You can go find that at sliceofscifi.tv, of course, and hear the entire interview. Plus, you could actually get to see the fragment. I didn't want to spoil it, so it's actually in there. You can see the exhibit and that little piece if you can't make it all the way out here to Arizona, which most of you can't, but I did actually let you see it. There you go.
Nice.
It was a lot of fun.
I've traveled millions of miles to see the asteroid.
thousands of miles and you don't show me the asteroid.
Meteorite.
Meteorite, yes.
Whatever.
Whatever the hell it is.
Transparent aluminum.
I have to follow that?
Yes, you do. Yes. Sorry.
With an accent, please. Just go. Dear.
With an accent.
Blending the Breakfast Club with Doc. No. Well, you asked me to.
That bless you for trying.
I want you to do the rest of the stories like that.
I don't do Scottish. I'm sorry.
That's it.
Well, Blending the Breakfast Club with Dawn of the Dead, the independent genre company, oh God, comedy, Detention of the Dead, hits select theaters this weekend. The movie follows a group of students, including a nerd, a jock, a cheerleader, a badass, and another nerd, and an outcast. Sounds too familiar. Mm-hmm. As they wind up in detention together, just as a zombie virus outbreak occurs. Oh, no!
Of course!
The group is forced to band together, not just to make it through detention, but to survive. The film is the directorial debut of Alex Craig Mann and stars Krista Allen and Jason Blair. So let's take a look at their trailer.
Absolutely.
Would you ever go out with a guy like me?
My friends would eat me alive.
No way, you got detention?
Yo, Mr. Rumbles! I think you should check Markman's hand.
That dude's got rabies.
It's not rabies. They're zombies.
Wow, if this isn't a commentary on the current state of public education, I don't know what is. These idiots trying so hard to fit into their little clique. We were a bunch of mindless zombies before any of this happened.
Chuck? Yeah, man, hit that shit.
In the library!
Why did we go there?
Not a single student would be caught dead there. Don't you mean caught undead there?
I've seen about every zombie movie there is, and going outside equals that.
Having fun in any way will get you killed. Having sex equals death.
You're a really great guy, you know that?
What?
So we're basically screwed.
It's time for this paladin to cast a 21st level spell, zombie whoop ass.
Where's Eddie?
Holding off the horse.
Okay. But he missed a few. Ash, stop taunting the undead.
Wow. I must see. We must see that. That looks so
really fun.
Oh my lord. It really, really does. Because the zombies are so much fun.
Zombies are blessed. That's all.
Detention of the Dead is also available to view via on-demand services. Through various cable and satellite providers, as well as Amazon Instant Video we're watching.
Cool.
You can find more at detentionofthedead.com.
Awesome.
Hey.
Nice.
Long-duration missions in space turned another chapter on Wednesday with a successful two-week-long space flight for three astronauts from China.
Mm-hmm.
While many international astronauts have spent way more time in space, this is a landmark achievement for the Chinese space program. With more on this accomplishment, here's a report courtesy of Euronews.
Three Chinese astronauts are back safely on Earth after a two-week mission to an experimental space laboratory, the Tiangong-1, or Heavenly Palace. The capsule of the Shenzhou-10 spacecraft re-entered the Earth's atmosphere and touched down at a remote site in northern China's Inner Mongolia region. The event was broadcast live on Chinese state television. It explained how the astronauts needed time to adjust to gravity before emerging from the capsule. This was the country's fifth human space mission and came 10 years after the first. The crew included China's second woman in space, Wang Yaping. During the mission, the spacecraft carried out successful dockings with the Heavenly Palace. China, which still lags behind space superpowers the US and Russia, eventually wants to establish a permanently manned space station.
They're lagging behind, but they're catching up quick.
Right?
Cool. Yeah, they are.
And good for them. I mean, you know, mm-hmm. regardless of politics or cultural differences, right? That was a big
it's
step
good
for
science.
Them.
Mm-hmm.
It's good for science. It's good for mankind. Yay.
It's good to bridge the cultural differences. It really is. I mean, I think science has always been one of those things that's really good about bringing cultures together because you start collaborating and you start thinking more intellectually than just the politics of state.
Mm-hmm.
And so, yeah, this is a very, very good thing.
We just need the U.S. to get on the metric system.
Yeah, oh, that would be nice. Oh, don't get me started on that.
I had to explain that to Brett's 14-year-old just this week. We had the conversation about why we're so backwards, and I didn't have a good answer.
Because I'm the mother,
that's why.
Just say, British pound.
All right. They don't get to judge.
Exactly. Oh, you know, I was remiss. I did have a really nice comment on the zombie subject here.
Oh.
Hey, Slicers, this is Catherine in Tucson. I'm a little bit behind, but I was just listening to your World War Z episode, and I just saw it this weekend, but I didn't have to pay any money for it, and I'm very glad for that, because it was not bad, but it could have been so much better if they had stuck to the source material. I got home and I found a copy of JMS's script online, and oh my god, it was so good. And it had the action, but it stuck to the story and had, you know, like the themes and whatever from the book that were just really interesting, as opposed to just, oh, random action movies, kind of thing. And it just, it's so sad that it could have been so much better than it was.
Mm-hmm. I've been hearing a lot of, it's a good movie, but it is basically the iRobot for Brad Pitt.
Yeah, I mean, I liked it better than I thought I would, which was surprising to me. It's not a bad movie, like she said, but there's not much plot. There's sort of a non-ending, and there's good action, and it's suspenseful.
It's not World War Z.
It doesn't bring anything new to the zombie film genre. Mm-hmm. The only other good thing it does is it's not gory and bloody like most of your zombie, like Walking Dead, even on TV, your movies. They don't do a lot of that gore and blood, which I'm good with because I can't watch those things. But if you like zombie movies for that, don't even bother. But it's an action movie. Yeah. It's not. It's a wasted opportunity.
Two things that I heard. One is that, well, there's going to be a sequel. That's already been determined.
They've talked about it, but it hasn't been officially greenlit because, again, in order to actually break even, what with the budget and all the advertising, they'd have to make like $400 million just to break even. Right. I don't think it's made that much yet.
No. Oh, heck no. But I heard that there was one would have been announced.
Maybe I'm behind the times. It's possible.
I don't know. The other thing is the people who seem to love this movie, I did a rather unscientific poll at work, and everybody who's seen this movie who loved it all have one thing in common. They never read the book.
Exactly.
And I never read the book, right? So I don't have that to compare it to.
That's why I say it's the iRobot version. Mm-hmm. Because if you haven't read the source material, then of course it's a great movie.
Or Starship Troopers.
Yeah. Or Starship Troopers.
Yeah, that's a good example.
Although I've read the book and I like the movie too. They're two completely different things.
They're totally different, and I will never ever forgive them.
Yeah, exactly. They are. Poor Megan. It's for the same reason why I do like iRobot. I just forget that it's iRobot and enjoy it for a Will Smith robot movie that's actually pretty good. So
it's a decent film. We watched it. Didn't we watch it the other day?
Yeah, not too long ago. We saw it. Yeah. Mm. Pretty good. Well, prolific writer Richard Matheson has sadly passed away.
Yes.
Matheson's career spanned 60-plus years, including novels, short stories, and scripts for television and movies. Some of the movies based on Matheson material include 1953's Hell House, 1956 The Shrinking Man, great movie, 1958's A Stir of Echoes, and 1978's What Dreams May Come. Now, Matheson's 1954 sci-fi vampire novel, I Am Legend.
There we go. We're talking about another Will Smith movie that absolutely bastardized the source material.
But was good if you ignore the source material.
If you ignore it, you have to. It inspired three different film adaptations. 64's The Last Man on Earth, starring Vincent Price. Mm-hmm. 1971's The Omega Man, starring...
The best one.
Which I agree. I love that movie with Charlton Heston. Mm-hmm. And, of course, 2007's I Am Legend with Will Smith. Now, Matheson was also responsible for writing several episodes of The Twilight Zone, as well as editions of The Alfred Hitchcock Hour, Rod Serling's Night Gallery, The Martian Chronicles, Amazing Stories. His Twilight Zone installments included, I love this, Nightmare at 20,000 Feet.
Oh, yeah.
That was one of the most famous. Yeah.
Absolutely. Both versions.
Both versions.
Yeah, with William Shatner
John Lithgow.
And Lithgow. Yes.
John
Lithgow.
Very cool. Ooh, very good. And we're, as we're saying with the TV show, it featured William Shatner as an airplane passenger who spots a creature on a plane's wing, as well as Steel, which inspired the 2011
Real
Steel,
yeah,
starring Hugh Jackman. Wow. Who knew that?
I did not know that.
I did not know that. So Matheson influenced several generations of storytellers. Among them were Stephen King, who dedicated his 2006 novel Cell to Matheson, and Spielberg, whose first feature-length film was a made-for-TV movie, Duel. I remember that movie.
Wow.
And that was also based on a Matheson short story of the same name.
I'm telling you.
Prolific is like the understatement of the year for this
guy. That's
crazy. Right?
He probably was writing several stories all at the same time. He's like the Mozart of writing.
And all super creative, fun, fascinating stuff.
And varied.
Right?
A lot of variation. Yeah. A lot of just different types of stories.
I mean, we look at Philip K. Dick is very prolific for the stuff that gets transferred to movies, but I mean, that's a pretty good lineage right there.
He covers the gambit in writing for different mediums.
Well, he definitely will be missed.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Let's put it that way.
So...
speaking of books, I have a little bit here for books.
Oh, yay.
Hey, Slicer Chief, New Jersey. 6 days, 41 hours, 20 minutes. You guys are talking about the next TV movie.
We went back in time.
One of the things that I think would be awesome and that I'd really like to see is a Kodak Calera by Jim Butcher movie. The Furies of Calderon, I think, would be fantastic. I think an HBO miniseries of it would be even more incredible. But I'd really, really like to see that on screen in some form. Cartoon, you know, movie, whatever. I think it would be great. There's a lot of neat ideas in it, and the story is really, really good. And if you like the Dresden Files and you haven't read Kodak Calera, you better get on it because it's just as good. But it's pure fantasy as opposed to urban fantasy. Have a good day, Slicer. Bye-bye.
I agree with that. I'd like to see Kodak Calera. I think that would be... It'd be, I don't know, it could be tough to bring that to film, though. Although, I think they could do about anything right now.
I think they can do about anything right now. I confess I love the Harry Dresden books, but I haven't made my way to that series yet. So, maybe I'll put it on my list.
Good series.
Hey, Slicers, this is Trampas. You know, I have a question I want to pose to you regarding the Lovecraftian mythos and Cthulhu. I see it as an influence in a lot of places, from literary works to role-playing games. So I have to ask you, is Lovecraft that good? Is it that it's an early influence and so there's that hint of nostalgia? Or is it that since it's in the public domain, people are getting lazy and not coming up with new ideas and just using it because they can? What do you think?
So I think something about his ideas sort of resonates. I don't know whether he's that good, but I think the basic idea of the Cthulhu-based mythos and the old ones is...
Mountains of Madness is actually not a really great story. Not, it doesn't really transcend the times as well.
I think he was better with ideas than actual writing.
And that's what I think. I think Cthulhu as an idea and the mythos around Cthulhu... The world building that he did is actually stronger than the story he told. Let's be real. And I think I love the Cthulhu thing because I love the Cthulhu idea, you know, that it's a creature that's so, you know, powerful and evil and so forth, you'd go mad just looking at it. It's like, wow, okay, that's a pretty cool concept. It's a pretty cool idea. So I think his ideas, like you said, is probably
and that may
better.
Be why that's kind of what survives, right? Rather than people constantly redoing the actual stories in movie or TV form or something like that, it's, you know, people
taking story
or
ideas.
Pay homage or whatever you want to say. Like, take those story ideas and do other things with it. I think that's pretty cool.
Which is essentially what legends and myths are all about. Is you just take what you know and you put your own twist on it.
Exactly.
There you go.
Hey, Slice, this is the Brownie Geek. I was just digging around IMDb, and I somehow ended up on the After Earth page. you know, the new Will Smith, Jaden Smith film. Apparently it says, quote, Will Smith has wanted to work with director Shyamalan for many years, but could not find a suitable project. I wonder why. Will Smith, who personally hired Shyamalan to direct the movie After Earth. You know, normally I really like Will Smith, and I love what he's grown into, but dear God, why?
Yeah, I know. I'm with you. I mean, I think that was probably the biggest mistake for this movie because it really missed the mark on a lot of areas. Although parents are really enjoying it because of the message that it's giving to kids, and there's a family element that's going on here. So maybe this isn't our movie. Could that be fair, guys? Maybe this isn't for us?
No, it could be. I talked to someone recently who thought it was a good movie, and I don't remember who it was, but it was the father-son relationship, mm-hmm. right? That
exactly.
was what attracted them rather than any of the
overdone
stuff.
Special effects and the really bad science and the
overdone action
and the oh my god, we have a suit that can do everything except change temperatures when
squirrel
it's cold.
Suit.
Mario squirrel did it first.
Suit. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm not sure this is our movie. I'm not sure that we are should even be commenting on it because I think it actually is more for a parent kid experience more than us, and that's story.
That's old grandpa's.
Yeah, that's kind of what I'm thinking.
You kids and your sci-fi.
Yeah, I know. You and your crazy movies.
Get off my movie.
Awesome. Hey, Slicers. This is Anna. I'm actually calling specifically for Sam, but you're all welcome as well.
Hello.
If you're ever in Richmond, Virginia, which I highly recommend you do at some point in your life because this is a fabulous city.
I used to live there.
We have a relatively new restaurant called Papa Pie Company.
Oh.
And don't be disappointed by this because they do, in fact, have a lot of sweet pies.
Ooh.
But the best part is the savory hand pies that they have as well.
Mm-hmm.
No pizza here, but definitely anything that is delicious to go between two crusts or just one crust if that's the way you like it. It is there, and you will enjoy it.
Yeah, I want to go.
My plug.
Yeah.
Come to Richmond.
Awesome.
I'll take you
right.
some
okay.
pie.
We're on our way. We'll be there. We'll be there in about 18 hours.
Slice
which would be great because I'm getting hungry again.
I'm a two crust guy myself.
It depends on the pie.
Apple
well,
pie.
That's true.
It depends on the pie.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Let's one more news story and we're going to call this show.
All right. So Pixar showered us with more of their animation genius last week with the release of Monsters University.
Mm-hmm.
So far, the lovable characters and hilarious script have banked $160 million globally and is still in more than 4,000 theaters heading into this weekend.
Wow.
Slice, turn to our chief movie review officer for a full
report.
Very
much. Oh,
yeah.
I'm sorry. I thought you were talking about my review.
Here's what he had to say.
Greetings, Slicers. Tim from the Bagcast here with a quick review of Monsters University, Pixar's prequel to Monsters Incorporated. This is more than a simple parody of the college movie genre, and more than a mere When Sully Met Mike story. A young Mike Wazowski enrolls at MU's School of Scaring in hopes of becoming a world-class scarer. Along the way, he faces challenges from the talented but lazy Jimmy Sullivan, arrogant Johnny Worthington of the Roar Omega Roar frat, and the frightful dean of the school, Miss Hardscrabble, impeccably voiced by Helen Mirren. The Pixar team infuses their characters with genuine emotion and motivation so that the conflicts in the plot come from their nature rather than storytelling contrivance. The humor is also character-driven and doesn't rely on stale pop culture references. I won't give you any spoilers here so that the twists remain fresh. Like all of Pixar's best work, there's a message here that underpins the proceedings without being ham-fisted. Suffice to say, Monsters University has a happy ending, not a sappy ending. Go see it.
Yes.
Yay.
Yes.
I have to agree with him. Keith and I saw it. We had a sneak preview. And you can read my review on sliceofsci-fi.com.
There you go.
Shameless plug. And then, yeah, we went again paid to see it last weekend. And it is just such a wonderful film.
I loved it. And I'm going to say art is my spirit animal.
Really?
Yeah.
Yes.
He was my favorite. He was my favorite.
I think he's everybody's spirit animal.
He's awesome. So go see it. You'll love it a lot. You'll laugh. You'll cry.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh. You guys, if you go to monstersuniversity.com, this is brilliant. This I do as part of my real life work is some content management systems. And this thing looks better than some of the universities that I've seen.
Really?
It does.
Absolutely.
I've been to the website. It is really, you'd think it's an actual University page.
I'm sending my second daughter here.
Yeah. Well, Pixar's been doing this for a long time. I mean, even their they did university ads, which look like something you might have seen for like Harvard or Yale.
I mean, the Pixar people are genius.
We have them up right now, and they're running on the video, and it is brilliant. It's really cool stuff, and it's a fun site.
Can you buy stuff at the MU store? Can I get
MU
shirt?
But I think you can actually get your student ID badge.
That would be awesome.
Yeah, it's there in front of you, actually.
Yeah, student ID cards. Oh wow. You can get a message from the dean, various school departments.
Mm-hmm.
Campus events. You can learn about campus events. Wow. And it's totally serious. They mean it.
Yeah, absolutely.
An ID card.
I like the hoodie with four arms.
Yeah. It just goes to show how brilliant the people at Pixar really are.
I want a meal plan from there. That's what I want. Yeah. Meal plan.
Absolutely.
Oh, love it.
Awesome. Well, I tell you what, with that awesomeness there, I think that's actually going to do it for this show, guys.
So are we done already?
We are done already.
Time
can you believe
flies.
It?
That went fast.
Time flies. That. And of course, you know where to go. You go to slicescifi.com, slicescifi.tv. You find us on the Facebooks, find us on the Twitters. Thanks so much, Chuck, for being with us.
And my pleasure.
He will be here for some more shows, I'm sure. Yay. I don't think we're going to get rid of him anytime soon.
Dang it.
Dang it.
Did I say that? I'm sorry. That was my outside voice?
She had to say her inner voice.
Ouch. All right. Talk to you later. Bye.